Glad you could join us. Welcome to the program. Passionate fans cramming into arenas to watch the world's best players. But when the competitors are sitting at computers, this is not live sport as we know it. Can esports overtake football, rugby, baseball, and all the rest? Welcome to Roundtable. I'm David Foster. Esports are already big business. Millions of players, hundreds of millions of players, countless fans and big name sponsors. But what is the attraction of watching somebody else play what is essentially a computer game? Here on Roundtable, we're tracking the rise of esports.
Esports will soon be worth $1 billion and attract 300 million global fans, according to the World Economic Forum, and none of it involves a ball or a pitch. Over 80 million players regularly log in to fight it out in a range of online video games, from science fiction to cards to battle games. And the very best players across the globe, from the US to Germany to China, compete in live international tournaments for million-dollar prizes. Last year, the International Esports Federation bidded to include esports in the Paris 2024 Olympics. However, Thomas Bach, the president of the International Olympic Committee, rejected it, saying that esports were too violent. But online gaming continues to attract big brands as sponsors. So, are esports the sports of the future?
With me at the round table, we have Chester King, who is chief exec of the British Esports Association. Ollie Ring here too, head of media at Esports Insider. Noor, Alkhadra, esports gamer and founder of WeGeek, that's a gaming events company. And Jonathan Rest, sports writer and news editor for Sportcal. Jonathan, you and I are the outsiders in this. We have three people who are experts and devotees of esports. So I'm going to start off by saying I don't think I am of an esports age when it comes to being targeted. I think you have to be under 30, and I'm just over 30. So try and convince me. No, you start. Try and convince me why I should love it.
Because it's fun. Because it's challenging.
I'm writing all this down.
And if you have any competitive sense in you,
yeah,
you'll enjoy it.
Very competitive.
Yep.
Why will I enjoy it, though?
Because you're like, you know, you're not dependent on your body. You're like beating people up with your mind.
Is that what it is?
There's one way to think about it.
Beating people up with your mind. Outsmarting people. Is that
what it is?
That's
from the level where you're competing yourself. In terms of the phenomenon of watching, it goes back to, I mean, a lot of people grew up watching cricket, watching golf. For a lot of children now, they grow up with iPads and cricket's too slow. A 5-day test match. Watching in Sydney, they're not bothered about the Ashes now. They want to watch their favourite YouTubers who can then go on and compete at the best level in competitive esports, right? So you want to watch the best, you want to watch the Ronaldos of a particular game, then that's why you watch them, because they are the best. And they can do things that when you play the game, if you went and tried to play Fortnite, for example, I don't think you'd be as good as your ninjas or your top players.
I don't think I would. but tell me here, I mean, is it... direct one-to-one when it comes to competing?
Yeah, so
you have a winner, you have a loser.
Yeah, so I think the key thing is to define esports is always a human versus human or human versus humans as opposed to human against a computer. Okay, so that's the key. That it's organized competitive video gaming, but it's always human versus human. So you've got that combat, as you were saying, competitive edge. So if you like beating someone at chess, football, whatever, in esports, you're beating someone playing a certain game. And there's kind of established about 40 different esports titles of various age categories and certain genres.
Okay, give us some of the genres, just so we know what we're talking about. We're talking about some shoot 'em up.
There are some shoot 'em ups, which are, and they're all age rated in the UK by PEGI. So there's
who's
a.
She?
PEGI, yeah, it's the European Association, yeah, PEGI.
Must be very busy.
Yeah. So you've got MOBA, which is a mobile online battle arena. So that's like a big map, like kind of Dungeons and Dragons format, and typically that's 5 versus 5. Then you've got first-person shooter games, and they can be teen-rated, like a 12-rated, like cartoon violence, like Tom and Jerry or Simpsons. And then you've got fighting genres.
So it's all fighting, it's all violent?
No.
Get on to the other
stuff. So Rocket League, I'd say, is one of our best. So we kind of focus on schools and colleges, 12 to 19-year-olds, and there's a game which is age-rated 3, which is 3 versus 3, playing football in rocket-powered cars. And it's an amazing game you're playing. And again, when you're playing esports, you're talking to your teammates, so you're learning some fantastic skills. And just the reason why people play it is there's massive intrinsic rewards. For these kids, they've got full autonomy. They can do what they want. There's a sense of pride and recognition for these kids. And as you said, there's no restriction on your physicality.
Yeah, exactly. I was going to say, however, it doesn't involve smelling the green grass, getting outside, getting dirty, getting muddy, getting a little bit physical. Is it a real sport? Because it's a virtual world.
I believe it's a real sport. I'm one of those people. yeah, because you're competing. There's prizes. There are players. There are rules. There are, I mean, now they were recently talking about, like, esports getting people getting injuries like carpal tunnel or whatever, like how is that going to be regulated? What does that mean for them? So I think...
You'll send the other player off if he's caused it. Jonathan, you and I are outsiders in this, but you're studying, you're becoming much more of an aficionado of esports. Do you understand the attraction and do you see any difficulties with the way that it's set up at the moment?
I understand the attraction because you just have to look at the numbers to see the attraction and why. I mean, I write about the business of sport and the big companies. You know, the companies that are involved in it now are the companies that are selling media rights to the Champions League and the Olympic Games. They are getting involved in, you know, selling media rights for, you know, big gaming events. So I see that the problem from a sporting point of view is the kind of governance and structure, and that's something that I know Chester probably kind of agrees with me on. Is, you know, there's this drive or there's this kind of behind the scenes noise for esports to get into the Olympic Games. It's not going to happen in the current format because the governance and the structure is not how the IOC want sports to be seen.
What, like the IOC is completely clean?
Not in a clean sense. They like to have a streamlined
like FIFA.
Yeah, well,
yeah. We've got rules, but there are rules, okay, and we're going to stick
absolutely
to them.
But in terms of how the sport is structured and governed, and who is in control, it is not of a level that can be in the Olympic Games. And I actually don't think. I mean, Ollie would know more. I don't actually think the game is.
I will ask you in a second, but I want to just finish with Jonathan on this particular topic. Could you, given the popularity of it, could you, let's say, fill a football stadium with fans who wanted to watch the best gamers? Is it at that
level? It's already at that level. I mean, you look at events in the US, in China, I mean, in Beijing, I think they filled the Bird's Nest. Was that 90, you know,
which
Olympic
is where
stadium.
They held the Olympic Games.
Sure, 80,000-90,000 seat stadium. Yeah, so yes, they can fill it. I mean, there's a dedicated cinema. Was a cinema in London that's now just for gaming. You know, it's clearly the interest is there and the fans are there. Yeah. Whether it's a sport is another matter. I mean, Noor, you open it up by saying, "I can't beat you in my body. I can beat you in my mind." That suggests to me it's a mind game. It's like chess. It's like bridge.
But sports gets the adrenaline going, and do you get the same level of excitement? You
absolutely.
Would, yeah. Well, describe a day as a. Well, sports woman.
I mean, first of all, like, if you're playing, like, I don't know, a game like Overwatch, you get that sense of, like, teammates and, like, you know, you fist bump and you're buddies and you're going at it and, like, it's the same adrenaline. Like, it's just mind, like, hand coordination, basically, instead of, like, using your whole body. It's, I mean, a lot of things, like, it makes you imagine you're in it. That's the power of the mind, basically.
Do you think there's a lot of extortion, corruption in gambling and so on and so forth?
Yeah,
the ability of outsiders to take advantage of this.
So there's quite a big betting scene in Asia, not so much over here. There's an organisation called ESIC that kind of checks games and results. But you know, the betting at this level, there aren't enough tournaments in the UK in particular to warrant that. We've had 3 majors, but just talking about, you know, tournaments, there's an event in Katowice in Poland that's been going for about 7 years called the Intel Extreme Masters. They had 177,000 people live over the 2 weekends, 44 million people watching it online. So we're filling out stadiums. In the UK last year, Wembley Arena, 30,000 people over 3 days, Birmingham Arena, 21,000, and the Copper Box as well. So these were 3 different majors that happened in the UK already that's happened.
Ollie, go on.
Yeah, I mean, the thing that you need to, when you look at the highest level of esports is all of the guys that you watch at the top tier, for example, of Counter-Strike at IEM, they're all in impeccable shape. They have nutritionists, they have physios, they have a strict gym routine. They have every little bit of structure that you would find in traditional sports now, because you reflexes are key, for example, in Counter-Strike, where a lot of it is based on how quickly you can react to certain things, and anything that can give you an edge over an opponent is therefore integral. So the kind of scene and people now are taking every little step to get that little bit of advantage in these games. So
you're not encouraging a generation or generations of couch potatoes necessarily.
No, exactly. No, I mean,
those people who watch it might just be.
But I think there's a difference between being a pro esports player, a gamer, and an amateur. So under UK law at the moment, we're recognised as a game like chess and bridge. In countries like Poland, chess and bridge is a sport, so esports is a sport. Most people in the industry in the UK, and we were discussing this earlier, are happy with that, because when you start becoming a sport, you get under regulation and media rights issues. So for us, we're navigating, everyone's got to do their sport, physical activity, everyone's doing homework, but at night, when it's dark, children can't play sport outside. So would you want them to watch passive media? Would you want them to be on social media? Or would you want them to play an activity that actually has massive cognitive benefits and life skills?
And what are the benefits?
So you've got you're learning about strategy and leadership because you're playing as a team. You are learning how to win and lose, which is pretty important, and you're actually physically using computers. So you're learning, you're going to cyber skills and dexterity. So we're working with the National Cyber Security, because that's a massive issue for them. I'm working with the armed forces as well, so they're creating esports leagues. So I think everyone's looking at esports, and everyone has a different kind of benefit that they're using. I think there's a massive commercial gain. I think there's a great elite level, but I think as a day-to-day activity, there's some really strong benefits.
Anybody at any time can say whatever they want, and Jonathan, you're an inquisitor. Like I am. So have you got any particular questions for those who are trying to sort of make sure the sports run properly?
Yeah, just one thing that's always interested me, obviously we've talked about the various different types of games, but there is a huge focus and the interest seems to be on the kind of violent games. I was just wondering from an education point of view, what's being done to teach kids the difference. It's obvious what the difference is, but clearly some lines can be blurred. Sure. And what's being done on an education point? You talked about the schools.
Yeah, so in the UK, we've got 100 schools and colleges playing different games. So we're using Rocket League, which is age rated 3, League of Legends, age rated 12, and Overwatch, age rated 12. We don't touch the kind of first-person shooters. And it's a bit like you don't take your kids to a horror movie if they're 12 years old. But there was a study done 4 weeks ago by the Oxford Internet Institute confirming that there's no link between violent games and being violent. If you watch, The Simpsons, and Bart Simpson's is strangling someone, these kids aren't going on the street and strangling people. So there's zero.
So
link.
You don't see any correlation between normalising violence in a virtual world and behaviour of people outside when it comes to the same sort.
If you're playing age-appropriate games, then no.
So if you're an adult and you watch people getting blown up, that's in no way is that ever going to...
There's been no proof at all, and Oxford University have just done a report on that.
Okay. You don't think it's normalising for you, violence, in any sense, if you play the violent games?
No, I mean, for me it doesn't affect me, but I think what's really interesting is how esports is growing, but also education and games is growing. So, Robonetica and Roborace, what we're creating, it's the first autonomous car racing vehicle in the world, and it's a company based in the UK. And we're actually creating an esports game to teach kids how to code these cars and how to code robots, essentially. So we're putting them through tournaments, and it's an actual game, but it's a good cause, and it's like more appealing.
And that is
parents.
Because you think that could be useful to them in their future careers and also useful to society. I mean,
absolutely.
Yeah? You're not
absolutely.
Being altruistic entirely about this.
No.
Though. Because they have fun and they take part in what you're being paid for.
Exactly. And the target group is the age that's into, kids are into esports, they're into gaming, and so why not make that a more useful educational kind of, thing?
There's career pathways, so you can do a degree in esports in the UK at university.
And what would you start off by learning?
So mainly about production around that. So there's a huge career pathways around esports. So when you go to a live event, like at Birmingham was Dota 2, there was 150 people off stage processing it. So instead of in football following a ball, you're following 10 players. So there's a skill set of people producing in real time those 10 players and about the best move they're going to do. And there's a thing called shoutcasters. So shoutcast is where Britain does lead the way, I'd say, in shoutcasting.
Indeed, yeah.
Yeah. So these are live pundits. So when you're in the audience looking at the screen and they're editing these top 10 moves.
A shoutcaster.
Shoutcaster.
As opposed to a newscaster.
Yes.
Okay, I get it.
And there's normally two.
You should try your arm.
Yeah. And they're talking and explaining to the crowd in real time the moves that are going on. So
seriously, I think I'd find it easier to learn Russian.
And you have specialists per the different titles. And yeah. Britain, you know, our English talent, we've probably, and, you know, these guys are earning hundreds and thousands of pounds. So there's a career pathway in being a shoutcaster.
Yeah, it's top tier commentary. So if you look across the board, if you look across the board, for some reason, it's something we're very good at. We haven't had, if you look in, I don't know, Counter-Strike, for example, the top players tend to be Danish or Swedish. They have long legacies. League of Legends, Korean players, been incredible for years. The UK hasn't quite got their global superstar that's done it all yet. But in terms of commentary, we're at the top of every game, whether it's FIFA, Counter-Strike. There's British casters everywhere. So
And these shoutcasters, not that I'm that interested, but they earn a lot of money.
Yeah. Enough. Depends on the game, depends on the level.
Okay. What about regulation, though, Jonathan? Because if there is a lot of betting internationally, it's easy to fix games, isn't it?
I'd have thought so. There's also an issue around doping. I know that's become quite a kind of prevalent issue within for gaming in terms of stimulants to keep players awake longer. And there is I believe some kind of integrity foundation that's been formed within esports to try and clamp down on that.
Yeah, so ESL tournaments already run doping on all of the winners, so you'll see, well, on all of the players. So you'll see as soon as they finish the game, they'll go backstage for testing. It's probably actually in a better structure than most of you hear about tennis, all of this stuff, and it's kind of ridiculous. And in terms of
betting, so they have to give urine samples?
Yeah, exactly.
And blood samples on occasion?
Kind of Adderall, Ritalin.
A banned list of substances.
Exactly, yeah. ESIC work hard.
You couldn't
hard.
Go they're in there with having taken cocaine. You couldn't go. Do you know people who take drugs when they're doing this? No?
No. I mean, I think, and for the betting side as well, you have, if you look at the way that the Premier League, you look at all of the leagues, say, for example, the second division in, I don't know, Thailand, you'd think at a football level that could be easily fixed and manipulated. The people that monitor betting patterns across the world, so Sport Radar and Genius Sports, they are set up in esports and they monitor the markets across the world. They work with ESIC, who also have a number of bookmaker partners who look at all of that and they spot unregulated bet. They spot
okay, betting so, so, so from the are. So from the bookmaker's point of view, it is regulated. But what about from the sport's own point of view? Because when it comes to a list of banned substances, in the Olympic Games, you have in cycling's association, make sure that these substances are not allowed. Who sets out a worldwide code of conduct for esports, or is it different everywhere?
So each publisher has its own rules and regulations, and then you've got tournament organisers. So ESL are probably the largest in the world, and they actually self-impose these rules and regulations already. And I've heard of no one being caught because it's just, you know, the community, if you get caught once, you're banned for life. You literally, the community will be so anti you as a player doing that. So I think they've put in these regulations and rules already to stop that. And what you need to understand is each publisher owns the full IP of their title. So they're in control of it. So they are self-regulating already. And there's some incredible organizations like Riot and Blizzard and Activision who already are doing this already.
When you as a player sit down to do this sort of thing, do you feel you are in a regulated environment that nobody near you or in another console could be taking an unfair advantage because the organizers are on top of it all?
Yeah, definitely. It feels like there are rules in it, but it doesn't feel like there's any cheating involved. I mean, regulation, I would guess, like when you're live streaming, I guess, on Twitch or something, there are like trolls sometimes that just send you things that are like, okay, why are you talking to me like that? But other than that, like, it's quite, I think, solid.
Can I be personal and ask you how much money you might make in a year from playing the games?
Oh, I mean, I'm not, like, I don't play, like...
You're not out there.
No, I'm not. But I did, how I met Ollie.
She did beat me attacking. She's good.
Yeah. Well, what was it? There was a fiver on it, or a cup of tea or something.
No bet, just a bit of fun. So I think someone won a signed Leicester football shirt from that competition.
So. The highest salary, which is mainly done in prize pool. So last year, there was $150 million in total prize pool of the 1,400 tournaments. The largest one is an event.
1,400 tournaments worldwide?
Professional tournaments, right. Yeah. One could argue a bit more, but the biggest one, prize pool, is an event called the Dota 2 International. Total prize pool was $26 million. Winning team of five guys won $10 million. So there's a few players that are earning kind of above $2 million $1 million a year being a professional gamer.
Mm-hmm. Can I just say that you don't appear of the particular age group that is most interested in this, a little bit like me, perhaps. I mean, how did you get yourself involved in all this?
Yeah, so I think you need to clarify, if you're a professional gamer, there is a sweet spot kind of between 18 and 24, but there's a lot of people my age in the industry, I would say, but yeah.
And so you're not 24.
I'm not 24, no. So I've got an 18-year-old son, and I've tracked his journey into esports, and I'm very pro-sport, so my uncle ran in two Olympics, I'm a member at Wimbledon, I worked at Wembley for 10 years, so I think sport is an incredible activity and very important life, and I think esports is an incredible activity, so I kind of bridge both worlds, and for me it was about framing esports to the right people and using it as an activity for good.
Where's it going to go next, do you think, Jonathan, as an observer?
I think you'll see it become a demonstration sport. That terminology has actually kind of died off in the
Which
Olympics.
Is like a sort of a half-hearted attempt at Olympic sport.
They
put it in just to see what it's like.
Yeah, they did it in the Asian Games last year. There were no medals, but it was a kind of test event. It's actually going to be a medal event in the Southeast Asian Games this year, which is kind of a bit of a regional thing.
Yeah.
I think, interestingly, in Paris, the organising committee recently released the sports that they would like to see added to the Games. And one of the things they're looking to do is, alongside the professional or the Olympic sailing competition, is to do an e-sailing event where you can kind of match yourself against what the actual athletes are doing. I think you'll see a lot more of that.
Because esports already has a massive profile, so it wouldn't encourage it that much more.
Yeah, though. I mean, it's kind of, people used to always, a few years ago, the debate in esports was, does esports need TV? Now people say, does TV need esports? So you get these circle jerk debates that go round and round and round and round. And the Olympics now, would it be cool to see it in the Olympics? Probably not necessarily.
It'd be quite nice to have the medal, though, wouldn't it?
I mean, but most of these youngsters, they haven't grown up watching the Olympics necessarily. Yeah. They don't care about a gold medal. They want to go. A lot of these teams are of mixed nationalities, so they're going out. You have, like, the world championship team you were talking about was two Finns, a Danish guy.
Do you always have to be in the same place, or could you actually be in different locations and play as a team?
Different locations,
as a team.
Yeah, so basically, to get to point, so live finals tend to be the top eight teams, which is always done in a live environment in a stadium. But obviously, the qualifying is done online.
Convince me, because we're coming towards the end of the programme. I've been fascinated by this discussion, and Jonathan may have other questions as well. But convince me that if I had a son of a particular age, and he's a bit older than the group that we were talking about, my daughters are older than that, if I had a teenage son, why should I want him to do this?
Well, because it trains his brain, and this day and age, like you mentioned, with social media and everything, you're better off, like, him doing this and actually getting into something that's going to help him develop, like, his memory skills, his strategy skills, and all these kind of things. Actually, when I was growing up in Saudi Arabia, I learned a lot of my English from video games.
And there were no restrictions in a country like Saudi Arabia on doing this, or did you have to do it?
No.
Away from authorities.
No. Actually, events? There are so many gamers in Saudi. It's insane. The top FIFA player is a Saudi guy. We're a desert, you know. We need to be indoors doing something.
I've been in the Middle East. I know how hot it can be and dusty. Where do you think it goes next?
I mean, this is a question that I tend to hate. We always...
Answer a question you love. You love answering
it. Well, no, I mean, the sky is the limit for esports. Who knows where it's going to go next? I couldn't tell you the next. I think there's going to be a shift in titles. We're seeing a lot of new games emerge that could become the next big esport, which is the fun thing, right? You don't see a new massive sport emerge, right? When was the last time I saw, that's a breakthrough sport? That doesn't happen. We're still in a very fun part of esports where a new game can come out and that can capture the imagination of millions. So what's going to happen in the next 5 years? There'll be a new title at the top.
Are you going to see esports supremos? Like in the UK, we have a very wealthy Russian oligarch who owns Chelsea Football Club. There are other people who are very wealthy who own football clubs in different parts of the world. Are you going to see somebody who takes control?
Well, if you look at the notable investors at the moment, I mean, a lot of it's venture capital funding in the US, but you say Drake, you look at all of these celebrity investors. Drake, J-Lo's got investment in esports.
So there already is a franchise model. So certain titles. So the Overwatch World League, they sold 12 franchises at $20 million each one. And a lot of them were owned by sports billionaires. So the people that own Minnesota Twins, and there were a few that were esports specific. So you've already got that infrastructure. Now they're going to bring out the Call of Duty World League as well, so as a franchise model. So, and League of Legends does that already. So there is, once you get deep into it, there's massive fragmentation, but you've already got people kind of focusing on it from a business point of view. But say from our point of view, being an like an amateur body, we're going in alternative provision schools, and these are kids that probably are slightly on the autistic end and they're not good at social environment. By forcing them to play with each other on their headphones, they're getting confidence and playing in that. So for me, about the future is it'll be an accepted mainstream. I think we mentioned that it's going to be in The Simpsons this weekend, an esports episode. So you're going to have this at the top level, the elite, the heroes. We don't have any in Britain. You know, we're doing national championships to create these future heroes.
So there is room.
You might be a bit old, unfortunately. Shoutcaster, you could be, or a host.
Yeah. I honestly think I think it might be easier to learn Russian, or to find Peggy out there somewhere.
Yeah. Wasn't there an esports team?
The Silver Surfers.
They're all
rubbish.
Like above 60.
Well, am I going grey?
Lost.
I've got to stop the conversation. Thank you, Jonathan. Thank you for coming in as an extra inquisitor, and I hope we can have a conversation with these and end up with a story for your organisation. Thank you for coming in. I've never seen enthusiasm like this for anything. It's fabulous. Thank you for watching. We'll be back with another edition of Roundtable very soon. From me, David Foster, and the team, we appreciate your company every single day. Goodbye for now.